Welcome to the last video in part 2 of our series on encryption and online security. And through it all, through all of the technologies we've seen and covered, all of the recent innovations, we still have the issue of authentication, of proving that you are who you say you are. And we're still using the long obsolete and fundamentally insecure method of user-generated passwords. We've covered the problems with the user coming up with his own password, and cover technology such as password managers to help people generate secure, random passwords and manage them for their sites. But even then, there are problems. As we've seen, not every website does a good job of securing passwords. Not even a secure, randomly generated password will protect you if the person can get the password database and decrypt them, or even just see passwords stored in the clear. Or if the website insists on sending you the new password in email over plain text whenever you change it. We just can't trust websites to do the right thing. But there are other ways, other things that websites can do to make your password safer, and we'll also look at a protocol that's just coming out which may obsolete passwords forever. First, we need to understand that there are three ways of authenticating you as a user: what you know, what you have, and what you are. What you know is something like a password. What you have is a physical item, like a card. And what you are is biometrics, like a fingerprint scanner. Passwords are what you know, but the other two methods give us a way of securely dealing with the problems of using passwords alone: multi-factor authentication. This is where you use more than one of these techniques to authenticate a user, reducing the chances that the theft of a password or whatever will compromise your security. A typical example that most people are familiar with is ATM cards. To use an ATM card, you not only need the card, what you have, but also the PIN, what you know. This is a form of two-factor authentication. This can be implemented on the web. Some banks, and even websites such as Twitter, allow you to use a form of two-factor authentication where, every time you log into the website, it sends a text to your phone with a single-use code. You punch in that code to complete your login. This is not what you know, as you might think, but what you have. You have the phone. You don't have prior knowledge of what the code will be, nor do you have any need to remember it. There are other forms that are more convenient. An app for iOS and Android called Google Authenticator is one. You set up a link to your Google Authenticator account once, then every time you log in, the website asks you for a code. The Google Authenticator app, without having to contact the website, presents you with a new 6-digit number every 30 seconds. Just punch in that 6-digit number, and the site knows you're in possession of your phone or whatever device you're using, as well as having knowledge of your password. What you know, plus what you have. Another way of doing this is with a special hardware device, such as a YubiKey. This is another form of what you have authentication. The key answers a cryptographic challenge to prove you're in possession of it. It's also possible to set up three-factor authentication, since we have three different ways to authenticate. So imagine you have Google Authenticator on your phone, but your phone is locked with a fingerprint reader. More and more phones are coming with fingerprint readers built in, and the latest versions of Android and iOS do a good job securing the fingerprint data. So you log in with a password, it asks you for the Google Authenticator code, and you use your fingerprint to unlock Google Authenticator and get the code to type in. In this case, you need all three: what you know, what you have, and what you are. But this does mean that there's no such thing as four-factor authentication, at least at the present time. The reason why is that you can't duplicate any of the factors. You can't have two what-you-know factors, for example. But this may change in the future. Some security experts are proposing other categories of authentication. One is what you can do. An experiment involving people playing Guitar Hero concluded that when people are given a repeated sequence, they learn the sequence not consciously, but through what's termed muscle memory. Moreover, everybody's way of remembering it through muscle memory seems to be unique, which would make it a form of uncrackable authentication. So a repeated task can be theoretically analyzed to see if it's the correct person doing it. Another is where you are. We already have this to a limited extent. Someone logging in on a local machine in a place of business is considered more likely to be the person than the same user logging in remotely. In other cases, some websites have a security precaution. If you log into your bank while you're on vacation in a place you've never been, the bank may email or text you an authentication code so you can prove it's really you. But this idea is controversial among security experts. Not only can someone's location be falsified, like we saw in the previous video, but where you are doesn't indicate who you are specifically, just someone who has access to the building. All of them agree it's useful, but many say it shouldn't be considered an authentication factor. Another might be when it is. If someone tries to log into your banking site at 3 a.m. when you're normally asleep, the bank might decide to take another precaution, such as emailing you a special code. But like where you are, this isn't true authentication, since logging in at a normal time doesn't indicate you individually. Now that you understand all of this, you can see why one often used authentication factor is a horrible one that should have died in a fire long ago, so-called security questions. This is when you ask for additional information such as your mother's maiden name. There are two major issues with this. The first is that it just isn't two-factor authentication. You're validating what you know authentication, the password, with another what you know form, something about your life. This alone makes the exercise completely useless. But that's not the really big issue here. The big issue here is that these are things that a hacker could easily find out. Your mother's maiden name can be accessed with the right records. The name of your childhood pet might prove useless if you blogged about it. Sometimes they try and get clever but fail. How many times have you seen, "What was your high school mascot?" Let's think about this. How hard is it to find out someone's high school? Whoever first came up with this question must have thought it was too easy, so he did what he thought would make it harder, asking the mascot. But if you can find out someone's high school, you can just go to that school's website and look up the mascot. Not to mention the fact that there are much fewer mascots than high schools because many get reused. How many Spartans or Knights are out there? And even worse, the same security questions are used over and over again by many different sites, and they often don't secure them with the same level of security they do passwords, even though they can be used to reset a forgotten password. And all it takes is one site giving up your mother's maiden name, your childhood pet, and your school mascot, and the hacker can hijack your account on any other site that uses those as security questions. One way around this is to randomly generate them. If you're using LastPass, for example, you can use its random password generator to make a unique string of text, and then put it in the LastPass entry for that site as a note, along with which question it goes to. But really, these are a horrible idea and should be avoided at all costs. Another option you've probably seen is for the website not to ask for a password from you at all, instead asking you to log in with a Google, Facebook, or Twitter account. All sorts of different accounts can be used for this, and it all uses an open standard for authorization called OAuth. The way it works is, a resource owner, Facebook for example, allows client applications, the websites you're authenticating to, what's called secure delegated access. Facebook will ask the user for approval to connect this client app, and if the user approves, Facebook gives the app a special access token. Once it has that, the only thing you need to log into the website is to be logged into Facebook as well. OAuth means that the website you're connecting to gets no information about your Facebook password, but it can get, based on user approval, access to the user's email and other information. But there are security issues with OAuth. Lead author Aaron Hammer resigned from the OAuth 2.0 project because OAuth became more complex, less interoperable, less useful, more incomplete, and most importantly, less secure. It no longer supports digital signatures, encryption, client verification, or anything else to make sure the connection is protected from spoofing or phishing attacks. Security experts have called it inherently insecure. OAuth also means that if your account on the originating website, Facebook or Twitter or whatever, is compromised, it can be used to not only get into your other accounts that use it for authentication, but it could also be used to sign up for new sites that you don't even know about. A clever hacker can keep quiet on your social media and other sites and set up lots of identities for you elsewhere, resulting in issues related to identity theft. Fortunately, the technology now exists to authenticate individuals without a trusted third party, and this is a new protocol that will allow us to completely obsolete passwords and OAuth and multi-factor authentication and allow anyone to securely authenticate without having to remember anything. It's only just approaching its 1.0 release, and so it'll have to be thoroughly vetted by the security community, and of course it remains to be seen if it'll catch on. But it seems likely that even if this particular protocol doesn't catch on, something similar to it won't be far behind. It's called SQRL, Secure, Quick, Reliable Login, and here's how it works. Alice wants to connect to Bob's server. She has the SQRL app on her computer or smartphone or whatever, and Bob has the SQRL server component running. Alice has a unique 256-bit ID stored and locked securely in her SQRL app. Bob's server sends Alice a URL that looks something like this. So what we have is a special link to Bob's website at example.com. When Alice clicks on this, the SQRL protocol tells her browser to open this link in her SQRL app. The SQRL app takes Alice's 256-bit identifier, appends the domain name to it, and then hashes it with SHA-256. It then takes the resulting hash and feeds it into ED25519, an elliptic curve algorithm that returns asymmetric keys for signing. Alice now has public and private signing keys that are unique to both her identity and Bob's server domain. The public key she just created is known as the SSPK, the site-specific public key, and will serve as her identity for the site. The NUT that she received from Bob's server is two things. It's a nonce, or number only used once, and it's also unpredictable, so no hacker has a chance of guessing it. Alice's SQRL app takes the NUT, signs it with her private key she just generated, and sends that along with the SSPK to Bob's server. She can then discard the two keys. Bob's server then looks at what it got from Alice. It uses the public key to verify the signature on the NUT, and if it checks out, he knows that the NUT was received by somebody with access to the private key that goes along with this SSPK. If this is the first time Alice is connected to the server, then Bob creates a new user for her using this SSPK as her identity. The next time the site authenticates, with a different NUT of course, her SQRL app generates the same key pair. So when Bob receives that signed NUT with the same SSPK, he looks through the database and sees a user already associated with that SSPK, so he knows it must be her and logs her in. When Alice authenticates to a different website, her SQRL client will generate a completely different key pair with a different SSPK to authenticate her. None of the information on one server will be tied to any information about Alice on any other server. Notice that Alice's SQRL app doesn't need to keep track of which website she's been to. It doesn't need to store any site-specific information, in fact, which means that the SQRL client can be kept to a small size and can also be exported to as many different devices as Alice needs without the need to synchronize anything. Another advantage of SQRL is the ability to authenticate from a different device. If Alice is in a library or internet cafe, she's not going to want to put her SQRL identity on that computer, as it's a major security risk. But she doesn't have to, because when Bob's server gives her the link, he also shows it to her in the form of a QR code. Alice can then take out her smartphone or other trusted device with her SQRL identity on it and use the SQRL app to scan the QR code. Now it's her phone that generates the keys and sends the signed NUT to Bob's server. Bob's server knows which machine it originally sent the NUT to, so he knows to authenticate Alice on that machine and not her smartphone. SQRL uses only standard off-the-shelf crypto that's been tested and found secure again and again, and is an open standard that's completely unencumbered by patents. The private key never leaves the client, and in fact isn't even stored. It only exists temporarily during authentication. Unlike passwords, the server has no secrets. If hackers get a hold of the public key, there's no way they can use it to log in as Alice on Bob's site or anywhere else, nor can they use it to regenerate her SQRL identity. Likewise, with cross-device authentication, that library computer gets none of her secrets and none of the information it would need to log Alice into that site or anywhere else. Of course, that does leave the question of, how do we authenticate ourselves to SQRL? How do we make sure we're the only ones who can access our identity? Well, on many new devices, we have some really secure options like fingerprint readers, but for devices that don't have it, the fact is, we're back to using a password. But think of it like the master password on your password manager. It's only used to unlock the identity and has nothing to do with how you log into websites. And SQRL has an excellent way of preventing someone else from trying to guess your password via brute force. When you put in your SQRL password for the first time, the SQRL app uses a modified SCrypt algorithm to make sure a certain amount of time is required to scramble the password, 5 seconds by default. When you put in your SQRL password at any point after that, there will be this brief delay. This gives an acceptable delay for evaluating your password while making it very difficult for hackers. they won't be able to try billions of passwords a second to crack it. Your master key is stored encrypted as a 256-bit number, and this is XORed with the result of the password key generation algorithm to get your unique identity. So this identity will have the full entropy of the master key. It won't be compromised if you use a lower entropy password. This also means that you can change your password anytime you like without changing your identity. Your identifier for each site is different. Your authentication is pseudonymous, with no way of using this system to track users between sites. The site-specific public key has no value to any other website or to any hacker. If a hacker gets the authentication data, no longer do we have to worry about whether or not the site has done its due diligence in hashing the password or whatever. There's also no way the hacker can use this key to impersonate you, because he would also need the private key that goes along with it. You don't need to worry about what other people are doing to secure the secrets that let you log in, because you are in sole control of that. This also solves the problem of synchronization among devices. When you create a login for a site in LastPass, that has to be stored in the cloud in order for you to log in from other devices. But SQRL doesn't have to sync these authentication keys. It doesn't even have to store them. No site-specific information is stored in this process. So when you establish an account using your SQRL identity on one device, you can automatically use any other device your SQRL identity is on to authenticate to it without anything having to sync up at all. If this takes off, it'll mean the end of ever having to type in any password other than your SQRL master password. Even if SQRL doesn't take off, it seems likely that something else will be developed in its wake. Either way, it looks like the days of online passwords may be numbered. And good riddance. This concludes part 2. In part 3, we'll look at how to secure your personal information, the things that don't need to be transmitted to or used by anyone else.